Chapter 6. Mulder strolled into his office whistling. It was the kind of day that began with a gorgeous, unreal sunrise, Hollywood at its best, and carried that promise so well, he was half afraid he was dreaming. The heat wave had broken 3 days before, bringing spring-like temperatures to the capital, light showers at night to wash the streets, and a steady breeze that had thus far kept pollution from hazing the blue sky. Leaves weren't dusty, the flowers were bright, it was so utterly perfect, it was damn close to sickening. But he'd take it. He wasn't that much of a fool. It took a second for him to notice Scully in his chair. "Morning," he said brightly. Since the meeting with Skinner, he had resolved two more knots in two more cases that had been bugging him for weeks. For a change, the agents involved were openly and immediately grateful, egos weren't bruised, and two more of the bad guys were on their way to capture. He also wasn't surprised that Beth Newhouse, unlike Bornell, hadn't come around to apologize for her behavior. In fact, he hadn't seen her for a week, another sign that life was good and maybe he'd been mistaken about the reprimand setup. All he needed now was a generous supply of sunflower seeds, and things would be perfect. "So what's up?" he asked, dropping his briefcase beside an overloaded desk. Scully reached down beside her, and tossed him a plastic bag. He caught it against his chest one-handed and held it up. It was a half pound of sunflower seeds. He smiled. A sign, it had to be a sign. The smile turned to suspicion. "You hate it when I eat these things. It gets messy. You hate messy." He hefted the bag. "What's the catch?" She shrugged innocently and reached down again, into her own briefcase. She wore a green suit and loose matching blouse fastened at the collar. "What's the catch, Scully?" he repeated, tossing the bag onto his desk. She held up a folder, waggled it, and placed it in her lap almost primly. He stared at the folder, at her, and at the sunflower seeds. They were definitely a sign, and he had no intention of reading it. Scully smiled faintly at his expression. "Don't worry. You'll probably like this one." He waited. She settled back in the chair. "So, what do you know about cattle mutilations?" "Oh, please, Scully, not that again, please." He crossed to a wheeled office chair and dropped into it, swiveling around to face her as he crossed his legs at the knee. He wasn't going to answer what was obviously a rhetorical question, until he realized he had to. She was preparing him, preparing his mind for something ordinary. Didn't describe. "All right." He clasped his hands loosely, elbows on the chair's arms. "Depending on who you talk to, you either have half-baked cults that demand bizarre sacrifices, cows being the animal of choice, secret government experiments in immunology based on actual and potential chemical warfare tests alone, or—" he looked at the ceiling. "Or experiments with alleged alien-based technology." He shook his head slowly. "To name a few." Without responding, she flipped open the folder. "The cattle are either bled, they have sections of hide and/or muscle and/or organs removed. Or they're just sliced all to hell and left in the middle of a field for some poor farmer to fall over." "So what? You know this isn't the sort of thing I—" he stopped, and they looked at each other. He had almost said, "need to know." He broke contact first, staring at the tip of his shoe. "Where?" "New Mexico." He barked a laugh. "Cattle mutilations?" "Right. Near Roswell, I suppose." "Come on, Scully, give me a break. I'm not about to get into that." She held up a pair of photographs without comment. After a moment he took them, after another moment, he placed both feet on the floor and leaned over, elbows now resting on his thighs. It took a while for him to understand what he was looking at, and when he did, he inhaled quickly. At first they seemed to be little more than solid masses of stained white and gray lying on what appeared to be bare earth. Sandy, grainy, maybe desert ground. A blink to change the perspective, and their forms resolved into the carcasses of animals that had been skinned, stripped in some areas right to the bone. There was virtually nothing left of their heads but exposed skull. The one on the left, she told him, hadn't been found for a couple of days. Its eyes were gone, and a closer examination showed him swarming ants, and a few flies the photographer hadn't been able to shoo away. Its hind legs had been twisted from their sockets, its mouth was open, the tongue still there, but it was much smaller, thinner than it ought to be, and evidently raw. Although there were shadows, and although he tried, he couldn't spot any pools or traces of blood. He glanced up, frowning. Blood? Scully nodded. I know, I've looked, too. If it's exsanguination, it's almost too well done. Otherwise, a one-shoulder shrug. Cauterization is about the only other thing I can think of. Based on the pictures, that is. To know exactly, we'll have to talk to those who were at the scene. At her direction, he checked the photograph on the right. Now that one, she explained, was found, they think, only a few hours after it happened. The eyes are gone there as well, but I can't tell if they've been surgically removed or... She didn't finish, she didn't have to. The blood thing again, he said, looking from one exhibit to the other. Right. And again, I don't have an answer for you. Not based on what we have now. Look close at the hindquarters, though. Twisted, just like the other one. I doubt if they're still in their sockets. There was a lot of force exerted there, Mulder. A lot. Meaning? Too soon, Mulder, you know that. Most of the hide is gone, although, she leaned over and pointed. It looks as if there are still some strips around the belly. Maybe between the legs, too. With all that muscle tissue gone or shredded, it's hard to tell. He looked up. This isn't just skinning. What do you figure? Flayed. She nodded cautiously, unwilling as always to commit until she had seen the evidence firsthand. I think so. I won't know until I've had a good look for myself. Then she handed him another pair. Puzzled, he took them, looked down, and rocked back in the chair, swallowing heavily. Jesus. People, they were people. He closed his eyes briefly and set the pictures aside. He had seen any number of horrors over the past several years, from dismemberment to outright butchery, but there had been nothing as vicious as this. He didn't need to look at them more than once to know this was something different. To put it mildly. Flayed. These people had been flayed, and he didn't need to ask if they had been alive when it happened. Skinner, right? The assistant director would have flagged this for him as soon as it had arrived. Scully nodded as she pushed absently at her hair, trying to tuck it behind one ear. The local authorities, the county sheriff's office, called, she checked a page of the file. They called Red Garson in the Albuquerque office. Apparently it didn't take him very long to think of you. Mulder knew Garson slightly, a weathered, rangy Westerner who had breezed through the Bureau Academy at Quantico, less with considerable skill, although he had it in abundance, than with an almost frantic enthusiasm born of a man determined to get out of the East as fast as he could. Which he had done as soon as he could. He was no slouch when it came to on-site investigations, so this must have thrown him completely. It wasn't like him to ask for anyone's help. Mulder, whoever did this is truly sick. Sick, deranged, or so devoid of emotion that he might as well not be human. He grabbed a picture at random, it was a couple, and he was thankful that what was left of their faces was turned away from the camera. Tied? Drugged? Scully cleared her throat. It's hard to tell, but initial indications are, she paused, and he heard the nervousness, and the anger, in her voice. Indications are they weren't. And Garson doesn't think they were killed somewhere else and dumped at the site. He rubbed a hand over his mouth, bit down on his lower lip thoughtfully. Autopsies by the medical examiner, a woman named Helen Rios, are inconclusive on whether they were actually conscious or not at the time of death. The lack of substantial quantities of epinephrine seems to indicate it happened too fast for the chemical to form, which it usually does in abundance in cases of extreme violence. A victim's adrenaline rush, he said quietly. Scully looked up from the report. Right. Something else, too. He didn't know what question to ask. They appear to have been dressed at the time of the assault. He shifted uneasily. Wait. Shards of clothing were found around each of the scenes. Not even that, no more than bits. Strips of leather from boots or shoes. Metal buttons. Scully, hold it. Her hand trembling slightly, she dropped the folder back into her briefcase. The pathologist says they either died of shock or bled to death. She inhaled slowly. Garson, in a sidebar, seems to think they were frightened to death, that they were dead before they hit the ground. Mulder waved her silent. Scully, these people, forget about the animals for a minute, these people were attacked by someone, or a group of someones, flayed until their clothes were shredded and their skin was taken off. He gestured vaguely. Shook his head. You're saying. They're saying, she corrected. Okay. Okay, they're saying it happened so fast, epinephrine hadn't had time to. He smiled without humor and looked blindly around the room. Scully, you know as well as I do that's damn near impossible. Probably, she admitted. I haven't had a lot of time to think about it. He stood abruptly. You don't have to think about it, Scully. There's nothing to think about. It's practically flat out impossible. Which is why we have to be at Dulles first thing in the morning. Stop over at Dallas, we'll be in New Mexico by 1 their time. She raised a finger to forestall a response. And remember, practically is the right word here, Mulder. That does not mean definitely. He stared at her briefcase, spread his arms at all the work yet undone he could see in the office, and said, what, at the twitch of a smile on her lips. She didn't have to answer. He usually reacted this way when a clear X-file landed in his lap. A switching of gears, of mindset, excitement of one kind changing to excitement of another. Impossible, to him, meant someone else had decided there were no explanations for whatever had happened. But there were always explanations. Always. His superiors, and Scully, didn't always like them, but they were there. Sometimes all it took was a little imagination to find them. A less hidebound way of looking at the world. A willingness to understand that the truth sometimes wore a mask. There's something else, she added as he reached for the sunflower seeds and his briefcase. What? She stood and brushed at her skirt. There was a witness to one of the killings. He felt his mouth open. You're kidding. He saw who did it. She, Scully corrected. And she claims it wasn't a person. He waited. She said it was a shadow. Brother, he thought. Either that, or a ghost. Chapter 7. A low fire burned in a shallow pit. Smoke rose in dark trails, winding fire-reflected patterns around the large underground room before escaping through the ragged round hole in the ceiling. Shadows on the roughly hewn rock walls cast by shadows seated on planks around the pit. 6 men, cross-legged and naked, their bodies lean and rawhide taut, string-like hair caught in the sweat that glittered in the firelight, their hands on their knees. Their eyes on the flames that swayed to a breeze not one of them could feel. Over the fire, resting on a metal grate, a small, flame-blackened pot in which a colorless liquid bubbled without raising steam. A 7th man sat on a chair carved from dull red stone, back in the shadows where the rite said he belonged. He wore no clothing save a cloth headband embedded with polished stones and gems, none of them alike, none bigger than the tip of a finger. In his right hand he held the spine of a snake, from his left hand dangled the tail of a black horse, knotted at the end and wound through with blue, red, and yellow ribbons. His black eyes were unfocused. Eventually one of the 6 stirred, chest rising and falling in a long, silent sigh. He took a clay ladle from the hand of the man on his left, dipped it into the pot, and stood as best he could on scrawny legs that barely held him. A word spoken to the fire. A word spoken to the smoke-touched night sky visible through the hole. Then he carried the ladle to the man in the chair, muttered a few words, and poured the boiling liquid over the seventh man's head. The man didn't move. The water burned through his hair, over his shoulders, down his back and chest. He still didn't move. The horsetail twitched, but the hand that held it didn't move. The old man returned to the circle, sat, and after shifting once, didn't move. The only sound was the fire. A lone man, waiting in the middle of nowhere. He stood in the center of a scattering of bones, coyote, mountain lion, horse, bull, ram, snake. And from where he stood, he could see smoke rising above Sangre Viento Mesa, rising in separate trails until, 100 feet above, it gathered itself into a single dark column that seemed to make its way to the moon. In the center of the smoke-made basket the moonlight glowed emerald. The man smiled, but there was no humor. He spread his arms as if to entice the smoke toward him. It didn't move. He was patient. It had moved before, it would move again. And after tonight, when the old fools had finished, he would make it move on his own. All he had to do was believe. Donna rolled over in her sleep, moaning so loudly it woke her up. She blinked rapidly to dispel the nightmare, and when she was sure it was done, she swung her legs over the side of the bed and sat up, pushing hair away from her eyes, mouth open to catch the cool air that puckered her skin and made her shiver. The house was quiet. The neighborhood, such as it was quiet. Moonlight slipped between the cracks the curtains left over the room's two windows, slants of it that trapped sparkling particles of dust. She yawned and stood, yawned again as she scratched at her side and under her breasts. The nightmare was gone, scattered, but she knew she had had one, knew it was probably the same one she had had over the past 2 weeks. She walked in the desert, wearing only a long t-shirt, bare feet feeling the night cold of the desert floor. A steady wind blew into her face. A full moon so large it seemed about to collide with the earth, and too many stars to count. Despite the wind's direction, she could hear something moving close behind her, but whenever she looked back, the night was empty except for her shadow. It hissed at her. It scraped toward her. When she couldn't take it any longer, she woke up, knowing that if she didn't, she was going to die. She didn't believe in omens, but she couldn't help but wonder. Now she padded sleepily into the kitchen, opened the refrigerator, and wondered if it was too late, or too early, to have a beer. Not that it mattered. If she had one now, she'd be in the bathroom before dawn, cursing herself and wondering how she'd make it through the day with so little sleep. She let the door swing shut with a righteous nod, yawned, and moved to the back door. Her yard was small, ending, like all the other yards scattered along the side road, in a stone block wall painted the color of the earth. Poplars along the back blocked her view of the other houses even though they were too far away to see even in daylight, unless she was right at the wall. Suddenly she felt much too alone. There was no one out there. She was cut off, and helpless. The panic rose, and she was helpless to stop it. Running from the room did her no good because she could see nothing from the living room window either. The rosebushes she had spent so much time training to be a hedge fragmented her view of the road, erasing sight of the field across the way. Trapped, she was trapped. A small cry followed her to the door. She flung it open and ran onto the stoop, stopping before she flung herself off the steps. Cold concrete made her gasp, cold wind plastered the t-shirt to her chest and stomach. "I am," she decided, moving back into town first thing in the morning. It was the same vow she made after every nightmare, and it made her smile. "Oh boy, tough broad," she thought sarcastically. "Think you're so tough, and a lousy dream makes you a puddle." She stepped back over the threshold, laughing aloud. But not loud enough, that she didn't hear the hissing. The smoke rose and coiled, and swallowed the emerald light. Mike Ostrand was a little drunk. Hell, he was a lot drunk, and could barely see the dashboard, much less the interstate. The gray slash of his headlamps blurred and sharpened, making the road swing from side to side as if the car couldn't stay in its proper lane. This late, though, he didn't much give a damn. The road from Santa Fe was, aside from occasional rises not quite hills, fairly straight all the way to Bernalillo, and into Albuquerque beyond. Just aim the damn thing and hold on to the wheel. He'd done it hundreds of times. He hiccuped, belched, and grimaced at the sour taste that rose in his throat, shaking his head sharply as if to fling the taste away. The radio muttered a little Willie Nelson. He wiped his eyes with one hand and checked the rearview mirror. Nothing back there but black. Nothing ahead but more black. The speedometer topped 70. If he were lucky, if he were really lucky, he'd be home by 2 and asleep by 2:10, assuming he made it as far as the bedroom. 2:05 if he couldn't get past the couch. He laughed, more like a giggle, and rolled down the window when he felt a yawn coming. Drunk or not, he knew enough to understand that cold air blasting the side of his face was infinitely preferable to dozing off and ending up nose down in a ditch, his head through the windshield. The air smelled good. The engine's grumble was steady. "And so am I," he declared to the road. "Steady as a rock and twice as hard." Another laugh, another belch. It had been a good night. No, it had been a great night. Those pinheads in Santa Fe, thinking they knew ahead of the rest of the world what the next artsy trend would be, had decided he was it. Living collages, they called it, the desert genius, they called him. "My God," he yelled, half in joy, half in derision. After a dozen years trying to sell paintings even he couldn't abide, he'd sliced a small cactus in half, glued it to a canvas, added a few tiny bird bones and a couple of beads, called it something or other, and as a lark, brought it north. They loved it. They fucking loved it. He had meant it as a thumbed nose at their pretensions, and they had fallen over themselves trying to buy it. The wind twisted through the car, tangling his long blonde hair, tugging at it, threatening a headache. 5 years later, 25 carefully assembled when he was roaring drunk canvases later, his bank account was fat, his home was new, his car was turned in every year, and the women were lined up 6 to the dozen, just waiting for his living desert fingers to work their magic on them. It almost made him sick. It didn't make him stupid. Trends were little more than fads, and he knew full well that the next season might be his last. Which was why he needed to hole up for a while, work through an even dozen more projects, and get himself out before he ended up like the others, flat broke and saying, "I used to be someone, you know, really, I was," while they cadged another beer from a stranger in a strange bar. The speedometer topped 80. The headache began. Acid bubbled in his stomach. The back of his hand scrubbed across his face, and when his vision cleared, he saw something to the right, just beyond the edge of the light. He frowned as he stared at it, then yelped as the car followed his stare and angled for the shoulder. The correction was too sharp, and he swung off toward the wide empty median, swung back again, hit the accelerator instead of the brakes, and yelled soundlessly when the right side tires bit into the earth off the blacktop. The car shuddered. He froze, turn into the skid. Turn out of the skid, and watched in horror as the low shrubs and deep ditch charged him and veered away at the last minute, putting him back on the road. Sweat masked his face. His bladder demanded immediate relief. His left hand shook so much he thrust it between his knees and squeezed until it calmed. "My God," he whispered. "Jesus, man, Jesus." 25, he swore to himself, he didn't care if it took until dawn, he wouldn't go faster than 25 all the way home. He wasn't sober, but he sure as hell wasn't as drunk as he had been. The speedometer reached 50. He saw the needle, saw it climb again slowly, and decided it would be all right. 60, no more, he'd be home quicker, and that was okay because he was a menace to himself out here. A hard swallow, a deep breath, his right hand flicking the radio off because what he didn't need now was interference with his concentration. Just watch the road, pay no attention to anything that. He saw it again. Just a suggestion of movement running with him on the other side of the ditch. Which was impossible. He was doing 65, for God's sake, there wasn't anything except another car that could go that fast. He squinted a stare, broke it off when the car began to drift, and licked his lips. There wasn't anything over there. Good God, there couldn't be anything over there. It was the headlights, that's all, running along a row of juniper maybe, or some pinyon, rock, something like that. His eyes caught the strobe-like reflection, and the scotch turned it into something that paced him. That's all it was. He wished the moon were a little brighter. Forget the new canvases, he decided a half mile later, the hell with it, he was done. He had enough money, the house was paid for, what the hell more could he want? The car jumped sideways when something slammed into the passenger door. He yelled, and watched his hands blur around the wheel, watched the road blur black to gray and black again, screamed when the car was struck a second time, and looked over to see what drunken idiot was trying to run him off the road. There was nothing there. When he looked back, it was too late. The highway was gone. All he could do was cross his arms in front of his face, close his eyes, and scream. There was no fire, no explosion. Mike Ostrand hung upside down in his seatbelt, listening to the engine tick, listening to the wind blow through the open window. Listening to the hiss he thought was the tires spinning to a halt. A few seconds later, he blacked out, when something reached through the window, and touched his arm. Chapter 8 La Mosca Inn sat between the Rio Grande and a high adobe wall that fronted the road. 8 units extended left and right from a central two-story building that housed the office, a large flagstone waiting room cooled by a small sparkling fountain, and a restaurant large enough to seat 100 without elbows and voices clashing. Spanish tile on the roof, shade provided by cottonwood and mountain ash, and a single huge Russian olive in the center of the courtyard. Scully sat on a wood bench that ringed the massive tree, facing the arched entrance whose elaborate iron gates were closed each night at, the proprietor told her, precisely midnight. She let her eyes close, and touched a finger to her forehead, to trap a droplet of sweat that had broken from her hairline. Feeling better, a voice rasped beside her. Not really. The day had gone wrong from minute one, she'd overslept and had to race to the airport, only to learn that the flight had been delayed. For an hour. Then two. Once airborne, she had planned to set up her laptop computer, so she and Mulder could go over what details of the case they had. It didn't happen. Roller coaster turbulence rode them all the way to Dallas, making reading the computer screen a nauseating experience. She spent most of the time trying, and failing, to doze. Then a series of thunderstorms ringing the Texas city forced them to swerve wide into a holding pattern until the squall line had passed. Another hour lost, and so was their connecting flight. Cursed, Mulder had said at one point. This whole thing is cursed. By the time they landed in Albuquerque, she was ready to believe in curses. By the time Red Garson had sped them in his jeep out of the city, north to Bernalillo, she was ready to spend the rest of her life walking. The man beside her shifted to get her attention. She opened her eyes and smiled at him wanly. Red was as Mulder had told her, a tall, lean, middle-aged man whose lined face and hands spoke of time spent in the mountains and the desert. She had no idea where he'd gotten his nickname, because his blonde hair was pale, his blue eyes dark, part of his left ear was missing, bitten off, he told her, in a fight with a man who had a strong aversion to spending the rest of his life in federal prison. Hardly a stereotypical FBI agent. When he smiled, only his lips moved, he never showed his teeth. He jerked his thumb over his shoulder. You think he's fallen asleep? I doubt it. A pickup chugged past the inn, backfired twice, and left a curl of black smoke behind. Dana? She nodded to show him she was listening. Why does he call you Scully all the time? I mean, you do have a first name. Because he can, she answered simply, without sarcasm, and didn't bother to explain. Just as it would be hard to explain why Mulder was, without question, the best friend she had. It was more than just being partners, being able to rely on each other when one of them was in danger, or when one of them needed a boost when a case seemed to be going bad, and it was more than simply their contrasting styles, which, perversely to some, complemented each other perfectly. What it was, she sometimes thought, was an indefinable instinct, a silent signal that let her know that whatever else changed, whatever else happened, Mulder would always be there when he had to be. One way or another. At that moment she heard a footfall and grinned. Here he comes. Garson looked startled, looked around and saw him walking along one of the stone paths that wound through the courtyard garden. She had to admit he looked strange without his suit. Over his shoulder he carried a denim jacket, not for appearance but to hide the holster he wore on his left hip. He also looked as frazzled as she felt. "It's hot," he said, dropping onto the bench beside her. "It's July, Mulder," Garson reminded him. "It's New Mexico. What did you expect?" "Heat I can get at home. An oven I already have in my apartment." He scratched through his hair and shook his head as though trying to force himself awake. "It isn't for everybody," Garson admitted, adding without saying so that everybody must be crazy if they didn't instantly fall in love with this part of the country. "And remember, you're a mile farther up than you were in Washington. Thinner air. Take it easy for a while, understand? You go shooting off in 14 directions at once, you're going to drop." Mulder grunted, then stood again. "Hey, look." He headed for the gate. "Mulder," Scully called. "We haven't time." He turned, grinning, and pointed to a small dust devil spinning lazily in the road. "We used to get these things at home. Leaves, you know." He moved closer, it was no higher than his shin. "We'd try to get inside." His foot inched toward the dervish's base and apparently broke some unseen barrier. The dust devil fell apart, and Mulder towed the place where it had been. Scully, who was already feeling the effects of the altitude, let the silence settle for a few seconds before she said, "Mulder, come over here, I think we'd better not waste any more time." She checked her watch, it was just after 4. "I suppose it's too late to catch Dr. Rios. What about, Patty? Patty Devon. Is she well enough to talk to us?" Garson stabbed a thumb at her as Mulder rejoined them. "She always like this. We have 3 people murdered, Red. The altitude didn't kill them." The man nodded, accepting the point and the rebuke without taking offense. "The Devons live about a mile down the road. They're fixing to head back to Chicago as soon as this is cleared up. I'll take you over, but I'm telling you now, that you won't be welcome." He was right. Scully caught the instant hostility as soon as Kurt Devon opened the trailer door and saw who it was. When Garson introduced his companions, the man scowled and told them to wait. Then he closed the door. Hard. Mulder nodded toward the river line of cottonwood 60 or 70 yards away. "Down there?" "Yep. The bank slopes sharp right about where you're looking. It happened a little ways to the right." Scully shaded her eyes against the low-hanging sun and tried to see it at night, with little but moon and stars for illumination. The trailer wouldn't help, it was too far away, and except for the skeleton of an unfinished house beside it, there were no other homes in the immediate area, even though she saw flagged wooden stakes in the ground, marking other lots soon to be developed. The nearest trailer was a good 60 yards away. The door opened. The 2 men stepped aside as a woman stepped down onto the cinderblock steps. She was short and slight, with straight blonde hair that needed a brushing, and a lost, empty look in her eyes. When she spoke, rage and grief made her hoarse. "She doesn't want to talk to you again, Mr. Garson." Red told her softly he understood, and apologized for the intrusion. But I have these folks here, Mrs. Devon. All the way from Washington. He cleared his throat, glanced at the open doorway. They're experts in this kind of crime. If anyone can catch them. Nobody has, she snapped. It's been 2 weeks, and nobody has. Scully lifted a hand to draw her attention. Mrs. Devon. The woman took her time, what? Scully kept her voice gentle. Mrs. Devon, I won't lie to you. I won't pretend to know how you feel for your loss, or how your daughter feels. But Agent Mulder and I have done this more times than I ever want to tell you. And if nothing else, I can promise you that we don't quit. We're not perfect, but we do not quit. Mary Devon's hands pressed lightly to her stomach, eyes narrowed. Are you promising me you'll catch him? No, Mulder answered, just as gently, just as firmly. We're only promising you that we won't quit. And if you don't want us to bother you, or your family, you won't have to worry. Mrs. Devon stared at the trees, blinking rapidly, then not at all. Just don't take her down there, she said, barely above a whisper. You take her down there, I'll lose her. Scully agreed readily, and said nothing when Mulder asked Garson to show him the scene. After all this time, there wouldn't be anything left of real value, Garson and his men and the local police would have raked it over thoroughly. Mulder, however, had a knack for finding things in barren places, a knack she didn't pretend to understand as well as she wanted to. Agent Scully. Wan, painfully thin, Patty Devon was the mirror image of her mother, right down to the haunted look. A fading bruise spread across her right cheek and temple. Her eyes were too large behind her glasses. They sat on two lawn chairs. There was no shade, and no offer of a drink. After a long silence, with the girl staring at the knot of fingers in her lap, Scully leaned forward and said, "What did you see, Patty?" "Nothing more." Mulder stood on the bare ground, checked the branches above him, glanced at the shallow river below. Here. Just about, Garson said. But, here, was nothing. The ground was too hard for tracks, and with no direct line of sight to the trailer, there was nothing much to work on. He asked Garson to stand approximately where Patty had been, and scowled. Dark night, 30 or 40 feet away, she wouldn't have been able to see much of anything. Flashes of movement that accompanied her brother's attack and screams. She saw a ghost because there was nothing true to focus on. He hunkered down and ran a palm over the ground. Have you had rain? Garson walked back, taking his time. This is what we call the monsoon season, Mulder. You wouldn't know to look at it now, but afternoons we get storms in. Big ones. Usually from the west, and they don't fool around. He shrugged as Mulder stood. Trouble is, rain washes the evidence away, and the ground's like rock again before noon the next day. This is a waste of time. Maybe, Mulder thought, maybe not. He walked north along the bank, gaze shifting slowly from side to side. Ahead, the underbrush was thick, still uncleared by the developers. He saw no signs that anyone had broken through, which meant they had either come from down below, or from the far side of the trees. It was something, and it was nothing. By the time he reached the other agent, he was scowling again. Gangs. Some. They headed back to the trailer. This is no gang hit, though. Knives and guns, nothing like this. Cults. They left the trees behind, and he felt the temperature already beginning to rise. Scully was still in her lawn chair, she was alone. What kind of cults you want, Mulder? We have New Age Swamis communing in the desert. We have the Second Coming believers who wander around the mountains and then use their cellulars when they get lost. And we have the Flying Saucer Nuts who figure Roswell is the key to all intergalactic understanding. A sideways glance Mulder didn't miss. That's kind of your territory, isn't it? The only answer was a noncommittal grunt, and Garson was smart enough to leave it alone. Scully stood as they approached, a brief shake of her head when he looked her a question. At that moment he couldn't help a yawn, and turned away so the pale face in the trailer window couldn't see him. He hoped he had been quick enough. The one thing Mary Devon didn't need now was the sight of an FBI agent yawning at the sight of her only son's murder. Garson saw it, though. "We're going back," he told them both, not giving them an option to refuse. "You two get something to eat and get some sleep, or you're going to be worthless tomorrow."
"Why? What's tomorrow?"
He touched his hat brim.
"Tomorrow, my friend, you're going to meet a genuine movie star."
Chapter 9. Mulder couldn't sleep. After a slow, almost lethargic dinner, he listened as Scully told him about the interview with the girl, which hadn't told her anything new. Patty had seen even less than her statement had implied. Almost as soon as the attack began, the branch club her brother had been holding spiraled out of the dark and struck her on the side of the face. She had fallen, dazed, and in that state thought she might have heard someone whispering, someone else laughing. But it was all too muddled, and she had passed out shortly afterward. It was her father who had found the body. "No ghosts, Scully," Mulder had said, walking her back to her room. "We're dealing with people here. You sound disappointed." He hadn't answered then, and he had no answer now as he put on a jacket and left the room, glad now that he had listened to Garson. Despite the day's heat, the desert was downright cold at night. He walked through a short passageway between the rooms and the main building, and paused. The back was a garden of cacti and now closed desert flowers set in random circles ringed by stone, as it was in front. Stone paths wound between them and joined at the back to lead to a half dozen benches that faced the river. Cottonwoods and willows were illuminated by miniature lanterns hanging amid their leaves, leaving patches of lazy shifting light on the ground. He wasn't sure, but he thought he smelled honeysuckle. When he was sure he was alone, he sat on one of the benches and watched what little water there was flow past his feet, electric lanterns on metal riverbank poles glowing just enough to turn the dark to gray. The moon was out. He shoved his hands into his jacket pockets and watched it for a while, thinking of nothing in particular until a slip of a cloud gave the moon a face. Patty Devon, or her mother, adrift in a darkness they would never be able to escape. Pale, only shadows for expression, only hints of what used to be behind their smiles. It was an all too easy, and all too painful, jump from there to his sister, gone too many years now. Taken when she was 8, by someone, or something, hiding behind the glare of a light that even now he couldn't think about without shuddering or squinting to shut it out. To try to see what was behind it. That was the foundation of his pursuit of the truths buried somewhere within the X-Files. He looked away from the moon and wiped a hand over his face, then absently rubbed the back of his neck. He would find Samantha, there was no question about it. Until then, however, the best he could do would be to find the men who had murdered Patty's brother. Again his hand passed over his face. When it slipped into its jacket pocket, though, a brief smile was left behind. "I'm okay," he said, shifting over to make room for Scully. "Just thinking. Out here, that'll get you pneumonia. Is that a doctor's truth thing?" She stretched out her legs, folded her hands on her stomach. "No. It's cold, that's what it is. God, Mulder, why can't you ever have a mood someplace warm?" They said nothing else for a long time, watching the river, listening to the rustle of the trees, once in a while listening to a dog bark or a car roar past the inn. For a while the garden filled with diners having after-dinner drinks as they strolled among the garden islands, conversation soft, laughter sometimes loud, for a while the evening breeze stopped, and they couldn't hear a thing but their own breathing. Then Mulder said, "Scully, has it occurred to you that maybe the people who mutilated those cows weren't the ones who killed Patty's brother and that couple?"
"No," she said at last.
She looked over.
"Why?"
"The history, Scully, the history. Animal mutilations of this sort aren't usually tied to murder. Particularly not brutal ones like these. The animals are assaulted, not people.
He watched her carefully as she looked away. He'd only been thinking aloud, but once the thought had been voiced, he had to make sure. "No," she repeated with a slow shake of her head. "Whatever was used, however it was done, the timing's too close, the similarity's too great. From what we've been told." She shifted uneasily. "I'll know more when I speak to the ME," but, she shook her head again. "No," a quick smile. "Besides, aren't you the one who told me that there are coincidences, and then there are coincidences? One is real, the other only an illusion." He returned the smile. "Yep. Okay. Well, this is no real coincidence, Mulder. The brutality itself is a strong indication of that. All we need to do is find the connection."
"Right. All we need to do."
"Then think about this, Scully," he said quietly.
"Why?
What's so damn important out here that both cattle and kids have to die?" She didn't respond, he hadn't expected her to. But he had a strong feeling, an unpleasant one, that whatever answer they finally uncovered, it would be one neither of them would like. In the middle of the desert, they had been dropped into a nightmare. "I am not crazy," Mike Ostrand insisted from his hospital bed. He glared at Sheriff Sparrow, who returned the look without expression. "I did not imagine the accident. I did not imagine this goddamn cast on my goddamn arm. I did not imagine my brand new car flipped over and left me hanging there like a goddamn Peking duck."
Sparrow was patient.
"Okay." Ostrand shifted uncomfortably, lips pulling away from his teeth in a grimace.
"Okay.
So I was a little drunk, I admit it. But that's not why I crashed."
"No, you crashed because some kind of mysterious vehicle, so low you couldn't see it out your window, deliberately forced you off the road."
Ostrand looked at him angrily.
"That's right.
And then it tried to kill you when you were hanging from your seatbelt." The artist shrugged, winced at the pain that exploded in his shoulder, and sighed capitulation.
"Okay, okay, so it was a stupid coyote, okay? So I was so damn scared it scared the hell out of me. It would have scared anybody. But it wasn't a coyote that ran me off the damn road."
"Good."
Sparrow nodded sharply.
"Now we're getting somewhere." He glanced down at the small notepad he held in his left hand, chewed on the eraser end of his pencil for a moment, and said, "Now, about that invisible vehicle." The Coronado Bar was unoriginal in both name and decor. As Bernalillo inexorably changed from an outpost on the Rio Grande into an Albuquerque bedroom community, the Coronado just as stubbornly refused to change with it. A long bar on the right-hand wall, tables and booths everywhere else, and a jukebox that muttered country western all day long. The TV on the wall in back never played anything but sports, minor league baseball tonight from Southern California. Smoke and liquor in the air, as many cigarette butts on the bare floor as in the aluminum ashtrays. It catered neither to the tourists nor the newcomers, and didn't much care that business didn't boom. It did well enough, which was well enough for its regulars. Indian territory was at the back. Although there were a handful of exceptions, most of the men who drove in from the pueblos stuck to the two last booths and three last tables. There was nothing belligerent about it, it just happened that way. Even the Spanish stayed away. Especially when the Conakine came to town. Leon Sayola nursed a long neck beer in the last booth. He was alone, seated under a wall lamp whose bulb he had unscrewed as soon as he'd taken his seat. He didn't like the light, didn't like the way the Anglos tried not to stare at the web of scars across his face or the scars on his knuckles. It was better to sit in shadow. It was also better to face the entrance, so when the man came in, Sayola would see him first and lift a hand in greeting, before a question could be asked or a voice raised. What he didn't need tonight was talk, debate. "What's the matter with your people, Leon? Don't they believe in the 20th century? The time for that was past. The others, Nick Lanea, Duggan Velader, fools like that, they could do their best to keep the talk alive, to deal with Anglo crooks like that Faulkner woman and sell the people down the river without an ounce of guilt. Not him. He had plans. They thought he was beaten. They thought his time away would change him. He drank, not sipped. It had. It had changed him. It had made him worse. Just before 11 the man came in, spotted him right away, and dropped heavily into the booth. Sciola tugged on the beak on his cap, a greeting and an adjustment. You're late. Shit truck wouldn't start. Wasn't for you, I wouldn't make the effort. Sciola watched him, hiding his distaste by emptying the bottle and waving it over his head, so the waitress, such as she was, would bring him another. The other man didn't ask for one, and one wasn't offered. So? Leon said. The man lifted one shoulder. So they brought in some FBI, straight from Washington. They came in this morning. One man, one woman. Sciola coughed a laugh. You're kidding. They're supposed to be experts. A woman? The man nodded, and offered a lopsided grin. Gets better. They're Anglos. The empty bottle was taken away, a full one left in its place. The man grabbed it before Sciola did, took a long swallow, and set it down. His fingers stayed around the neck. Am I worried? No. Good. The man stood and hitched up his pants. I hate being worried. It always pisses me off. He left without a word to anyone else. The bartender turned up the baseball game. Sciola wiped the bottle's mouth with his palm and drank the rest without coming up for air. When the waitress returned for the empty, he grabbed her wrist, just strongly enough to keep her bent over the table. Chica, he said softly, what are you doing tonight? Getting a life, she answered, yanking her arm free. Try it sometime. He laughed. Not a sound, but he tilted his head back and laughed. Wonderful. She was wonderful. He wiped a tear from his eye and shook his head. Since she didn't want him, he would leave her the biggest tip she had ever had in her miserable life. And to make it better, he wouldn't even kill her. Scully massaged the back of her neck. It was hard to keep her eyes open, and she didn't bother to hide a yawn. The desert night air, Mulder said. It's almost too peaceful here. I know. She dropped her hand into her lap. The point is, Mulder, we haven't enough data yet to show us why they were killed, much less explain the connections in any reasonable fashion. And I don't think we're going to find them out here. Not tonight, anyway. She smiled wanly. I think I'm a little too punchy. We both are. He stretched one arm at a time over his head, clasped his hands, and pushed his palms toward the sky. I just wish I could see the connections between a handful of cows, a kid by the river, and a couple in the desert. He brought his arms down, one hand again moving to his nape. Mulder, relax, we just got here, remember? Besides, you have to remember that the thinner air out here slows down the intellectual process, the result of less oxygen flowing to the brain. He grinned and looked at her sideways. Is that a doctor thing? No, that's a Scully thing. She grinned and pushed off the bench and held out her hand. When he grabbed it, she pulled him up, turned him around, pushing him lightly toward the motel. The doctor thing is, get some sleep, like Red said, or you'll be useless in the morning. He nodded as he waved a weary goodnight over his shoulder, sidestepping a garden wall just before he tripped over it. Another wave, I'm okay, I know what I'm doing, before he disappeared into the passageway, and she couldn't help wondering what it was like for him, seeing things other people sometimes couldn't, engaging in a pursuit with oftentimes terrifying intensity, looking so young and deceptively guileless that there had been many times when he was severely underestimated. She wasn't surprised when, passing his room on her way to bed, she saw light slipping around the edges of the drapes. Exhausted or not, he would be up most of the night, turning over what he knew, and setting up what he didn't know so he would know the right questions to ask, beyond the how and who and why. She wished him luck. Right now, she was having difficulty remembering her own name. She fingered her key out of her pocket, moved on to the next room, and stopped as she inserted the key in the lock. "You're tired, Dana, that's all." She looked anyway. The inn gates were closed, the lanterns out. Only a faint glow from a nearby street lamp reached over the wall. A man stood at the gate, arms loose at his sides. She couldn't see his face or his clothes, just his outline. Tired, she reminded herself, and pushed into the room, flicked on the wall switch, and, as she closed the door, checked the gate again. He was still there. Watching. Chapter 10. Mulder didn't have to be outside to know it was hot and getting hotter, even though it was just past 10. Even with sunglasses, the sun's glare was almost too much, and to stare at the passing scenery too long made it jump and shimmer, showing him things he knew weren't there. There were no clouds, no signs of rain. It was hard to believe there ever was. He rode with Scully in the back seat of Sheriff Sparrow's dusty blue and white cruiser, Garson up front on the passenger side. It was evident from their conversation that the two men had known each other for a long time, using shorthand gestures and single-word answers, mostly grunts. As far as Mulder could tell, the gist of it was, there had been no further incidents since the death of the boy, except for a drunk driver who claimed to have been forced off the road by an invisible, or incredibly short, vehicle. "It brings out the nuts, this kind of thing," the sheriff said, lifting his gaze to the rearview mirror. "You find that, too, Agent Mulder?" He nodded. It was true. Just as it was true that Chuck Sparrow was laying on the Western Sheriff routine a little thick, constantly hitching his gun belt, chewing a wad of gum that was supposed to simulate tobacco, getting a deeper drawl in his voice every time he opened his mouth. It wasn't necessarily a bad thing, but it made him wonder why the act at all. Garson would have already filled the man in, and it was the sheriff who had finally asked the FBI for help. It didn't sit right. Like not wearing a suit and tie, like wearing running shoes. He knew Garson was right, wearing his usual clothes out here would have been ludicrous as well as stupid, still, like the sheriff, it didn't sit right. The Sandias passed them on the right as Interstate 25 left the Albuquerque suburbs behind. And although other ranges broke the horizon, there was nothing out there now but the high desert. And the sun. "Colt," Sparrow said then, raising his voice to be heard over the air conditioning. "What?" Scully, startled out of a reverie, asked him to repeat it. "Colt. You know, Colt. One of them Satanist things, probably. Look hard enough, betcha them poor folks were all involved somehow. A 17-year-old boy?" Mulder asked skeptically. "Hey, that ain't no rare thing, you know what I mean. You got your heavy metal crap with all that subliminal stuff, you got your rap stuff telling kids to kill cops, shit like that, drugs and sex." He lifted a hand off the wheel, palm up. "What more do you want?" Mulder saw his eyes in the mirror, watching him, gauging. "Maybe," he answered reluctantly. "No maybe about it, son, no maybe about it." 15 miles later, at a speed Mulder thought would soon launch them into orbit, the cruiser slowed, pulled onto the right shoulder, and crossed a narrow wooden bridge. A 2-lane paved road led into the desert. Sparrow pointed with a thumb. "What you got up there, them hills there about 10 miles along, is what they call the Conakine Wall." He scratched under his hat. "Kind of like a jagged outline of a light bulb lying on its side. Fat part, it's pointing toward the Sandias back there to the south. The base part, it crosses the road onto the ranch where we're going. Unless you want to climb the hills, the only way in or out is a gap where the road is." Mulder watched a barbed wire fence blur past on his left. Beyond it was desert, and he couldn't imagine how anyone could raise anything out here, much less cattle. When he had asked at breakfast, Garson only told him to hold on to his horses, he didn't want to spoil the surprise. "Do the Conakine fit in here?" Scully asked.
This case, I mean.
Sparrow shrugged one broad shoulder.
Who the hell knows?
Doubt it myself.
Their place isn't like the other pueblos, see?
It's a residential and all, but they don't like tourists, they don't like Anglos, they don't like other Indians, he laughed.
Hell, I don't think they much like each other a whole hell of a lot.
He yanked at an earlobe, then scratched vigorously behind it.
Some of them, mostly the young ones, they've been trying for years to change things.
Most of the time it don't work, though, and they leave, don't come back.
And the ones who do?
Well, he glanced at Garson.
Nick Linnea, right?
Garson nodded agreement and half turned so he wouldn't have to yell.
Nick's a good guy.
He went off to college and came back with enough ideas to fill a canyon.
Because of his family, he's on the tribal council, so he has to be heard.
And he is, believe me.
Trouble is, not a lot are listening.
So why does he stay?
Garson thought a moment before saying, because they're his people.
Sparrow chuckled, sarcasm, not humor.
Doesn't hurt he's making a few bucks, Red.
Garson sighed dramatically, a wink at Mulder to signal what was obviously a long-standing argument.
Nick, he explained, has a deal with a local woman, an Anglo, Donna Faulkner.
He brings out some of the crafts the Conakine make, she sells them in town or up in Santa Fe, they each get a cut and the tribe gets the rest.
Mostly jewelry, he added.
Once in a while some incredible bowls and ceremonial style plates, things like that.
Every time he brings out a load, he has a fight with the other side, who claim he's selling their heritage down the river.
And every time he brings back the bucks to the mesa, Sparrow said sourly, they line up with their goddamn hands out.
The mesa?
Scully said.
Sangre Viento Mesa, Garson explained.
It's in the middle of the reservation.
Their homes are at the base, their religious ceremonies are held up top.
What does that mean, Sangre Viento?
Garson faced front.
Blood wind.
It means, blood wind.
Eventually the barbed wire gave way to a short stretch of well-maintained split rail. In its center was an open gate over which was a wide wood arch burned into the face was double H.
Mulder sat up as Sparrow drove under the arch, onto a hard ground road.
He looked between the men in front and saw what surely had to be a mirage.
A wide expanse of impossibly green grass inside a blinding white fence, a long adobe and Spanish tile ranch house so simple in its design it looked prohibitively expensive, a stable and corral behind and to the left, with a small black horse plodding toward the shade of a tree he couldn't name, a two-car garage behind and to the right, the driveway curving around the fence to join the entrance road in front, ristras, strings of dried red chilies, hanging from vigas protruding from the walls.
Beneath a porch that had to be 50 or 60 feet long.
You want to be a millionaire and live like this, Scully?
I wouldn't mind.
Sparrow parked in a cleared patch of ground beside the driveway, took off his hat and slicked his hair back.
He opened the door, and paused as he leaned forward to slide out.
I would appreciate it, he told them, if you wouldn't bother her too much.
She only found the bodies.
She didn't see anything else.
From that unsubtle warning, Mulder fully expected a withered and frail woman to greet them, not the beautiful woman who came out of the double front doors and stood on the porch, shading her eyes and smiling.
Scully joined him while Sparrow fumbled with the gate latch, and as they approached the porch, a man and woman stepped out of the house and moved to one side, she in a simple white dress, he in work clothes.
Their expressions were anything but friendly.
"Hey, Annie," the sheriff called, and when they were close enough, he made the introductions.
Annie Hatch, Mulder thought as he shook her cool dry hand and looked down into those incredibly green eyes.
So this is Annie Hatch.
As she waved them to seats around a wrought iron table, it was clear Scully liked her at first sight.
You know, she said, accepting a tall glass of lemonade from the woman in white, this is like finding an oasis, it's so lovely.
Annie's eyes widened in pleasant surprise.
Why,
thank you. But it's just my home. She smiled broadly, and 10 minutes later, the three of them were chatting as if they were old friends, long separated but never far from mind. Mulder didn't believe for a minute she was acting. Another 10 minutes passed before he sat back, abruptly sobered when she noted but didn't remark on the holster at his hip. She caught the change in his mood instantly, and took a deep breath. You want to know what I saw, and how? If you don't mind, Mrs. Hatch. She rolled her eyes. Oh, for God's sake, Agent Mulder, please call me Annie. And I don't mind at all. Her gaze shifted to the improbable lawn and the desert beyond it. They were newlyweds, you know. They were on their honeymoon. He knew, he had read the report so many times, he could have recited it word for word, footnote for footnote. Doris and Matt Constella, from Kansas, 25, in Albuquerque only 4 days, and, from all Garson could figure out, on a wandering drive around the county in a rented van. They had already stopped to visit at least 2 of the pueblos, and it was there, it was supposed, they had heard about the Conokine. There was no other reason why they'd be on that road. There were no signs, not for the road itself, and not for the ranch. She explained how she had discovered their bodies, and how she had immediately ridden back to call the sheriff. Near the gap, she said sadly. They were right by the gap. So much for the connection between them and the boy, Mulder thought. Mrs. Hatch, Scully began, and cut herself off at the woman's chiding look. Annie. Have you had any trouble with people from the reservation? Annie blinked once, slowly. No. She's lying, Mulder thought, and looked to his left when he sensed movement. Nando Quintodo had taken a short step forward, one of his hands fisted at his side. When he saw Mulder look, however, he stopped, his face bland, his hand quickly relaxed. Why do you ask? Annie said. It's routine, Mulder answered before Scully, and grinned at her skepticism. I know, it sounds like a line from a movie, but it's true. We've been told there's some trouble, and, an apologetic gesture. We can't afford not to ask. Scully echoed the procedure, and apologized as she took Annie through her story again. Mulder, meanwhile, stretching as if he were too stiff to sit, rose with a muttered apology and left the table. As soon as he took a step, Quintodo walked away from him, heading for the door. Mulder spoke his name. When the man turned, his hand was a fist again. Mulder leaned against the porch rail and looked out over the lawn. He didn't raise his voice, he knew the man could hear him. Tourists ever call you Tonto? Not here. No tourists here. Flat, unemotional. Careful. But sometimes. There was a pause. Mulder waited. Yes. In town. Sometimes. Still flat, still unemotional. Mulder faced him, leaning back against the rail, one hand in his pocket. You're from? Quintodo's eyes shifted to the table, shifted back. The Mesa. Your wife, too? He nodded. So tell me, Mr. Quintodo. Why would a woman like that want to lie? The sheriff, mumbling something to Annie, stood. Quintodo saw him, and Mulder couldn't miss the flare of hatred in his eyes. Why? He repeated softly. But Sparrow was already on his way over, a mirthless grin beneath dark glasses. Why what? He asked, rubbing a hand over his chest. Why would I want to visit the stable when I don't ride? Mulder answered. I'll tell you why, because I'm a city boy, and I'd like to be able to see manure firsthand. Very well, Mr. Mulder, Quintodo agreed before the sheriff could say anything. I will show you everything. Mrs. Hatch, she has a pair of very fine horses. I think you will be impressed. Maybe you will learn something. He nodded politely to Sparrow and went inside without looking back. The sheriff hitched up his belt, and spat over the railing. This is a beautiful place. Yes, it is. Annie's been alone out here for a long time, you know. Some say too long.
I wouldn't know, Sheriff.
Sparrow spat again. Let me give you some advice, Agent Mulder.
Always ready to listen, Sheriff Sparrow.
You're the expert around here, not me.
Sparrow nodded sharply, damn right.
Okay, number one is, Nando, there is a conokine. You know that already, I assume.
Don't trust him.
He may live out here with Annie, but his heart's still over the wall.
Mulder said nothing.
Second thing is, he stopped. He took off his hat, wiped sweat from his brow with a forearm, and shook his head as he walked back to the table.
Mulder watched him.
The second thing, unspoken, was a threat. End of part 2. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and remember, the truth is out there.